in attendance with when Bernie and Harry Belafonte stood on the stage, the Apollo stage, the historic Apollo stage in New York, and reminisced on their time marching with Martin Luther King, which that's like prolific. You know, not many people touched that, and not many people got the opportunity to march for that movement. And then I heard him talk about getting arrested in Chicago for the fight against segregation in schools, and his time serving as chairman of the Congress of Racial Equality, and in his time at the University of Chicago. I mean, then to boldly take a stand on that same stage and stand up for the Palestinian people, and say something so simple and revolutionary and true, that both sides' needs should be considered to bring about peace. That's so simple, so true. I also would like to mention that I read last night that he spoke about the same thing in 1988. He's been giving these speeches his whole life. I heard him on a stage in Brooklyn be the first and only candidate to say that we owe a great debt to the Black Lives Matter movement for bringing awareness to systemic racism and law enforcement. Those are his words. He champions our activism and he stands with us. He stands for the fight for 15, for the fight against Wall Street corruption, income inequality, wage inequality, immigration reform, the union strike, matters that affect so many diverse, disenfranchised, and marginalized people. I have fallen in love with his message for equality. His policy proposals for demilitarizing our police, re-enfranchising more than 2 million people of color who have had their right to vote taken away because they've had felonies. Banning for-profit prisons. Taking marijuana off the federal list. Social security expansion. Turning back from the war on drugs, not to mention free child care, free pre-K, free college, universal health care, supporting the DREAM Act, and improving affordable housing. These are all things that in effect level the playing field for communities of color and low-income communities. I feel like I found my true culture, the culture I've always been looking for in the Bernie Sanders campaign, a culture of inclusion, not exclusion, a culture of multiculturalism, a culture where everyone's voice is heard, especially those who have been neglected and excluded for so long. These are not radical things. These are human rights. These are truths. Again, during times of deceit, telling the truth becomes a revolutionary act. Now it's our job, as people have said before me that have come up here, it is our job to go out there and be revolutionary and spread the truth and get to the polls, bring 5 people with us, tell all of our friends about it, and be the media for Bernie. To get this truth-telling activist to bring activism to the White House. The next person I'm going to bring up is an amazing individual. His name is Josh Fox. And he's been a strong voice against fracking. And he's also been a strong voice going and stumping with us in New York, and I got the pleasure to join him on that journey. Josh Fox, come on out!
I love Pittsburgh. It's my second home. I want to say thanks to Troy Polamalu and Jerome Bettis for being great environmentalists, and Antonio Brown for just being great. Those of you who've seen my film Gasland, you know that Pennsylvania is suffering, and you know how love Pennsylvania, and you know how much that hurts. From all across the state, from the Delaware River to the Susquehanna to Harrisburg to Potter County and Fayette County and Greene County and Washington County. And yes, to all around this great city of Pittsburgh, which was the first city in the world to ban fracking. First, number one. So do we have any fracktivists in the house? Do we have people from this great city that beat the largest and most powerful industry on the face of the planet in the house for Bernie Sanders? The Democratic Party has been co-opted. Co-opted by the big banks. Co-opted by corporations and big donors and the 1%. And yes, co-opted by big oil. And I am here this afternoon to take our party back. There is only one candidate that has correctly identified climate change as the number one security threat to the United States. Who is it? There is only one candidate that does not take money from the fossil fuel industry. Who is it? There is only one candidate who is for a total ban on fracking in the United States. Who is it? There's only one candidate who stood against the war in Iraq and for gay marriage before it was popular. Who is that? And there's one candidate who we're going to elect as President of the United States. Who is that? That's right, Bernie Sanders. Because, listen, we know the Democratic establishment and incrementalism, along with Republican obstructionism, has failed to protect us. It has failed to protect us from the ravages of the big banks. It has failed to protect us from economic inequality. All of the income gains in the last 8 years went where? To the top 1%. It has failed to protect us from fracking. It has failed to protect us from climate change. And yes, right now, the Democratic establishment has failed to protect democracy itself. We know about voter suppression happening all across America. Pittsburgh is my second home. I went and voted in my first home in Brooklyn just a week ago. And I know from reading the New York Times that not mine nor nobody in my whole building's vote was counted. And I don't know why. And I want to know why. In a world where it's impossible to like a Facebook post twice, we should be able to vote from our computers at home. Why do we have to register at all? This system is broken, and there is one candidate that is standing up. There is one candidate who is telling us the truth. That is Bernie Sanders. We need a total systemic reform in the United States. We need a system that's based on people and not on dollars. Climate change, and economic inequality are fundamentally linked.
Country, when we frighten
the top
the job 10%
creators, don't create jobs. Is responsible for 50% of worldwide emissions. 50%. That means economic inequality and climate change are meshed. They're the same issue. That's why we need to transform our energy system. That's why the political revolution is also an energy revolution. It is an energy revolution. And we know from CNN the revolution won't be televised, but we know that the revolution will be solarized. I'm so proud to stand here with all of you today. Because when the frackers came to my front door in the Delaware River, and they surrounded my property with leasing, I never felt more alone in my entire life. I never felt more scared. I never felt more like I was about to lose everything that I loved. But now I know I'm not so alone anymore, right? And that's what we need. We need to work together. We need to work for community, for human rights, for democracy, for resilience, for creativity, for love. We need to work for a different value structure, not the one that's based on greed and competition and consumerism and racism and violence.
United States of America is the most powerful nation in the world. Yet, the way in which we treat many of our citizens is a shameful display of our power.
For hundreds of years, African Americans and their allies stood up and fought back against racism, segregation, and bigotry.
We have been woke from the dream, the beautiful dream, of having our first black president, only to find ourselves entering into a new era of mass incarceration and police brutality that we call the new Jim Crow.
People like Michael Brown, Sandra Bland, and my father, Eric Garner, and the list goes on and on.
This campaign is listening to our brothers and sisters in the Latino community.
Todos sabemos que el sistema no está funcionando en este país. No está funcionando para ninguno de nosotros.
And the money that's made from the rigged economy is paying for the political campaigns. And they say they're going to fix things. Wake up, America. How are they going to fix a broken system when they are profiting from a broken system?
What this campaign is about is telling Wall Street and the billionaire class they cannot, they will not have it all. We want a government that represents all of us, not wealthy campaign contributors.
Since the recession of 2008, we have seen the erosion of the black middle class get worse. We've not just lost our jobs, but we've lost the homes that we worked so hard to build. So whether it's the fight for $15 an hour or for affordable housing, the policies that the next president enacts will either set us on a course towards poverty or prosperity.
People should not have to work two or three jobs just to get by, and then after all of that, 58% of all new income goes to the top 1%. That's wrong.
We live in the greatest country in the world, and yet so many of our citizens can't get an education. And if they do, they end up paying their student loans for the rest of their lives. Education is a right, not a privilege.
Instead of schools, they build prisons for profits and fill them to the brim with more people than any other society in history. We must disrupt the school-to-prison pipeline, reform our criminal justice system. The time is now.
I'm from Scotland, right? It's not a particularly rich country. It's not nearly as wealthy as the United States of America, for example. Yet, everyone has access to free education and healthcare. Why do we have that in America?
We should not be punishing people for getting an education. And instead of giving tax breaks to billionaires or fighting wars, we should not be fighting. We're going to be investing in housing and education and healthcare.
This election is not a popularity contest. It's not about who you like or who you want to go have a beer with. It's about our future. It's about our children.
What this campaign is about is creating a political revolution.
From Strong Island to Staten Island, Queens to the Boogie Down, BK, Manhattan, we need you, New Yorkers. Don't be just liking this online. You got to get in line. It's time to vote, show up, represent.
At this crucial moment in American history, we need my brother Bernie because he's a man of integrity, honesty, dignity, and courage. And he's got a vision that focuses on everyday people.
Real change takes place when millions of people look around them and they say, you know what? The status quo is unacceptable.
We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union,
establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense,
promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our prosperity.
Do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America.
Hey, Bernie from Brooklyn, talk to the people!
To paraphrase Abraham Lincoln at Gettysburg, this is a campaign of the people, by the people, and for the people.
I'm Bernie Sanders, and I approve this message.
Kevin Lotta,
Marjorie Kruger, Kendrick Sampson, and Josh Fox. And of course, Senator Jeff Merkley of Oregon for being here today. We got some important things to talk about, and a lot of it has to do with your future. When we began this campaign about a year ago, there was a general feeling that young people and students were not really interested in government, were not interested in politics, but a lot has changed in the last year. And what young people have shown is that they understand that they are the future of our country, and they intend to play an active role in shaping that future. And what young people have also shown is they understand a lot more than the pundits and the so-called political experts think they understand. They understand that if we do not transform our economy today, your generation will, for the first time in the modern history of America, have a lower standard of living than your parents. Now, my dad came to this country at the age of 17 with no money. Our family never had any money. But my parents worked hard so that their kids could do better than they. That is called the American dream, and millions of families have accomplished that. And that's what the American dream is. The American dream is, I work hard, my kids can do better than me. Together, you and I and millions of other Americans will not allow that American dream to die. You are entitled to a good standard of living, you're entitled to a decent job, and you are entitled to live in a country where the environment is healthy and where you have access to health care. And here is something else that young people throughout this country have told me. They have said, how does it happen that when we do what our parents tell us to do, what our teachers tell us to do, what our community tells us to do, and that is go out to great universities like this one, get a good education, why is it that we end up $30,000, $50,000, $70,000 in debt? Now, I have talked to young people all over this country. Talked to a woman in my own city. Her dream was to become a medical doctor. She did it. She's practicing medicine today, $300,000 in debt. Talked to another woman in Iowa. We need dentists in this country. Major shortage of dentists. Graduated dental school, $400,000 in debt. Talked to a young man in Iowa, dropped out of college after 2 years. $60,000 in debt. Talk to a mother in New Hampshire who today is paying off her student debt as well as her daughter's student debt. Talk to a guy in Nevada. He's been paying off his student debt for 25 years, is more in debt today than he was when he took that debt out. We can do better as a country. What this campaign is about is asking you to think hard, to think outside of the box, to think outside of the status quo, to not accept the choices that the media or Congress or politicians give you. Because very often they are false choices. And your job is to ask, how does it happen that in Germany,
in Scandinavia and in other countries around the world, they think it is a good idea to invest in their young people so that they have a workforce which is extremely well educated. Should we be punishing young people for the crime of getting an education? I don't think so. So what are you going to do about it? All right. What we've got to do is fight back, and here is the good news. The good news is the vast majority of the American people agree with us. And this is what people agree with us on. Number one, when we look at education today, please understand that a college degree today is more or less the equivalent of what a high school degree was 50 years ago. You know what I mean by that? 50 years ago, you had a high school degree. You were pretty well educated. You could go out and get a good paying job and make it into the middle class. Today, in many respects, that's what a college degree is about. So number one, when we talk about public education, it's not good enough just to talk about first grade through 12th grade. What we have got to talk about is making public colleges and universities tuition free. Does anybody here think that that's a radical idea? It is not a radical idea. It is a common sense idea. Why is it common sense? Because over the years, the world has changed. The economy has changed, technology has changed. Your generation needs more education than previous generations to get the good paying jobs that are out there. That's just a simple truth. And therefore, we've got to make public colleges and universities tuition free. And the second thing we've got to do is to make sure that you do not leave school deeply in debt. Because if you leave school deeply in debt, what it means, you're going to be paying, depending on your debt, depending on your job, a significant percentage of your income in student debt, paying off that debt. And that means, you know, you may not be able to get married, you may not be able to have kids, you may not be able to own a home, you may not even be able to buy a car. That's pretty crazy. So what we are fighting for now is to allow people with student debt to refinance their loans at the lowest interest rates they can find. Now, the reason that this campaign is doing well and why we have won 16 states so far, and why, with your help, we're going to win here in Pennsylvania tomorrow. The reason is that we are doing something very unusual in contemporary politics, and that is we are telling the truth. That's right. You know, truth is a funny thing. Truth is not always easy to deal with in our personal lives or in our political lives. And there's a mechanism that we all have that kind of doesn't want to always deal with truth. We kind of want to push it aside. But the truth is that either in our personal lives or in our political lives, we do not go forward unless we confront the reality that we face. You can run away from it, but at the end of the day, it's going to backfire on you. So what we have to do in this campaign, I'm not here to give you, you know, a song and a dance and give you poll-tested ideas. I'm here to challenge you to help me to address the major crises that we face as a nation. And I'm sorry to say to the young people, I wish I could say differently, that you have bequeathed a lot of really serious issues. And we're going to have to work through these issues. Can we do it? Of course we can. This country has tremendous intellectual capabilities. We are hardworking people. We can address these issues together. But before we address them, we have to acknowledge their reality. All right? And Senator Merkley of Oregon, who was here a moment ago, touched on some of those issues. All right? All of you read when you were in elementary school and you're in high school, you read about how the United States is one of the leading democracies in the world, right? That's what they were taught. Well, now let me disabuse you and tell you that that very democracy that men and women fought and died to defend is in trouble today. All right? And this is a hard reality, but here is the truth. Today in America, you got to vote. But there are other people in this country who not only have a vote, they're going to spend hundreds of millions of dollars to elect candidates to represent the wealthy and the powerful. All right? That's not what democracy is about. Democracy is not a hard concept to understand. It means one person, one vote, majority rules. Democracy is not about billionaires buying elections. If everybody here had a vote, but there was one person over there who spent $200 million on the election, that one person would have more influence over what goes on in Pennsylvania than all the rest of the people here combined. And that is not what democracy is supposed to be about. So what we have got to do is a number of things. We got to think it through. How do you create a vibrant democracy? Number one, we overturn this disastrous Citizens United Supreme Court decision. Number two, I suspect that some of you, because you're here today, might be giving thought that at some point in your lives, maybe running for office. Maybe you got ideas that you want to fight for. You live in a democracy, you might want to run for office. Well, I want you, no matter what your views may be, progressive, conservative, moderate, whatever, I want you to be able to run for office based on your ideas, not having to hustle money from millionaires and billionaires. Think about a democracy where candidates are not spending half their lives raising money, but are actually communicating with constituents, listening to constituents. Thirdly, 2 years ago, in November of 2014, we had a national election, not a presidential election, but a midterm election, which we elected Congress and members of the Senate. 63% of the people did not vote in that election. Approximately 80% of low-income people and 80% of young people did not vote. What we have got to do is revitalize American democracy and make everybody understand. I know you got a good football team here. Football's a spectator sport. Democracy is not a spectator sport. And that means that every person here has got to understand that you are very, very powerful people if you choose to exercise that power. And if all you choose to do is moan and groan and complain, it doesn't matter. Nobody cares. So you got to figure out how you make yourself powerful. And that means, of course, voting in elections, but it means more than that. It means figuring out how you can most effectively fight for your rights. For example, I mentioned a moment ago making public colleges and universities tuition-free and lowering student debt. There is not, I am a United States Senator. I know a little bit about this. There is not the slightest doubt in my mind at all that if millions of college students told the United States Congress very clearly that it is unacceptable that they are leaving school deeply in debt, Congress will change the law. They will make public colleges and universities tuition-free. Why? Because they're politicians. They listen to people. They don't listen to people if people are not involved. So if you do not stand up and fight, who are they going to listen to? They're going to listen to the people who contribute hundreds of millions of dollars. Who cares that you leave school $50,000 in debt? Who cares that there are some kids in Pennsylvania who can't afford to go to college? Who cares if we don't hear from those people. And your job is to be heard. No, we love each other. That's what we do. We love each other and we care for each other. And we gotta work together to pull this country out of where we are today for a better future. All right? When we talk about where we are, I mentioned what I think is the absurd situation regarding higher education. Let me also say this while we're on the subject. I grew up in a family, did not have a lot of money. My parents never went to college. There are kids right here in Pennsylvania, in Pittsburgh, Philly, wherever, whose parents never went to college, who do not in a million years believe that they will ever go to college. It's like going to the moon. It is not in their worldview. Our job is to make sure that every kid in Pennsylvania and America understands that if he or she does well in school, takes school seriously, you know what? They will be able to get a higher education. But it's not only higher education. It is the whole rigged economy that we are living in today. What do I mean by a rigged economy? A rigged economy is heads I win, tails you lose. A rigged economy is where we have massive levels of income and wealth inequality. A rigged economy is where today the top one-tenth of 1%, one-tenth of 1%, owns almost as much wealth as the bottom 90%. Does that sound like the United States of America? I don't think so. Here's what the rigged economy is about. The rigged economy is about that 40 years ago, one worker in a family could earn enough money working 40 hours a week to provide for his or her family. Today, you need mom working, you need dad working, you need the kids working, and as often as not, they end up in debt. We have got to think that through why it is. A rigged economy is millions of people in this country working longer hours for lower wages. A rigged economy is when almost all new income and wealth, 58%, goes to the top 1%. You got that? People working really crazy hours. In America, we work the longest hours of any people in the industrialized world. And yet 58% of all new income, over half of income, goes to the top 1%. People on top doing phenomenally well. Everybody else becoming poorer. Now I see some guys from the CWA. CWA, how are you? And I want to thank these guys. And CWA members all over the East Coast, IBEW members as well. You know what they're doing? They're on strike right now. They're on strike against Verizon. Not easy for them to do. They're not getting their paychecks today. Not easy for them and their families. You know why they are on strike? They are on strike because Verizon is an enormously profitable corporation. But what Verizon is now doing is telling these workers that their health care benefits have got to be cut. Verizon is telling workers here in this country who work for Verizon that the jobs they now have in calling centers are going to be outsourced to the Philippines or other low-wage countries. So Verizon doesn't have enough money to pay these guys their health care benefits, provide jobs in this country, but amazingly enough, they do have $18 million a year to pay their CEO. But these guys, men and women in the CWA, are not taking this sitting down. They are fighting back. They're fighting for every worker in America, and I thank them. And that's what the American economy is about today. CEOs making 200-300 times more than their workers making. And what the economy is about is a disastrous trade policy. Now, I know trade is not a sexy issue. It's not mentioned on television virtually at all. But what trade has done to this country, unfair trade policies, NAFTA, permanent normal trade relations with China, shut down thousands of factories throughout this country, millions of people lost their jobs. Jobs go to China, go to Mexico. If elected president, we are going to reverse those trade policies. Now, one of the differences of opinion that Secretary Clinton and I have is precisely on trade. She has supported virtually every one of these disastrous trade policies. I have opposed all of them. One of the other differences that I have with Secretary Clinton, unlike Republicans, she understands that climate change is real. And that's a step forward. Because you got many Republicans who are so indebted to the fossil fuel industry that they refuse to even acknowledge the reality of climate change. That's right. But I believe that if we are going to transform our energy system away from fossil fuel to energy efficiency and sustainable energy, you know what we need to do? We need a tax on carbon. And that is what most environmental economists believe is perhaps the most effective way to bring forth that energy transformation. That is my view. That is not Secretary Clinton's view. Now, there's another area, and I know that it is a controversial area right here in this part of Pennsylvania. I know that, and I know that not everybody is going to agree with me. But I believe that in the future of this country and in this world, one of the great pressing problems will be whether or not we have clean drinking water. And Secretary Clinton and I have a difference of opinion. And again, I am not unaware of what goes on in western Pennsylvania. But I do believe that if we are going to preserve clean drinking water in this country, we have got to end fracking. Secretary Clinton disagrees. And Secretary Clinton, when she was Secretary of State, actually strongly pushed fracking technology on countries around the world. Here's another important difference. The federal minimum wage today is $7.25 an hour. That is a starvation wage. Nobody can live on that. Can't live on $8. You can't live on $9. What I have believed from day one in this campaign is we've got to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. I have been on the picket lines with workers fighting for a $15 an hour minimum wage. Secretary Clinton's view is that we should raise the minimum wage, but only to $12 an hour. To the seniors and the disabled vets of Pennsylvania, there is another difference between Secretary Clinton and myself. I believe that a great nation is judged not by how many billionaires it has or how many nuclear weapons it has. It is judged by how we treat the weakest and most vulnerable amongst us. There are many seniors and disabled veterans in Pennsylvania and in Vermont who are trying to make it on $10,000, $11,000 a year Social Security. You don't hear from them. They are sitting right now in some small apartment wondering about how they can afford the medicine they need, how they keep their homes warm in the wintertime, how they eat the kinds of, get the nutrition that they need. They're suffering quietly. Nobody hears from them. Our Republican colleagues in the Senate, they think we should cut Social Security. And while they want to cut Social Security, they want to give huge tax breaks to billionaires. Well, I've got some bad news for them that ain't going to happen. We are not going to cut Social Security. We are going to expand Social Security. And I have outlined some very specific ideas as to how we expand and extend Social Security, and I continue to challenge Secretary Clinton, support my legislation. Let's make the elderly people in this country know that we are together in expanding Social Security benefits. This campaign is listening to ordinary Americans and not just wealthy campaign contributors. We're listening to women. Women are telling me they are tired of earning 79 cents on the dollar compared to men. And I know that all of the men here will stand with the women in the fight for pay equity. And women and all of us are tired of hearing Republicans running all over this country talking about family values when you and I know what they mean by family values. And what they mean is that no woman here today, no woman in America should have the right to control her own body. I disagree. And when Republicans talk about family values, they are also talking about denying our gay brothers and sisters the right to get married. I disagree. I am a member of the U.S. Senate Committee on the Environment. And let me be as straight as I can with you, because I've learned a little bit being on that committee. The debate is over regarding climate change. And it is a very sad state of affairs that you have a major political party called the Republican Party, which in most instances refused to acknowledge the reality of climate change. Or the fact that it's pretty pathetic. You know why it's pathetic? Because you cannot do public policy. You cannot make rational decisions if those decisions are not based on science. And this is what the scientists are also telling us. And I think that for the younger people here, this is going to be the struggle of your generation. What the scientists are telling us is if we do not act boldly in the next several years, a bad situation is going to become much worse. And what that means is more drought, more flood, more extreme weather disturbances, more acidification and destruction of the oceans. It's going to mean rising sea levels, where coastal communities will be flooded. It's going to be more international conflict. Why? Because if you don't have water and you don't have land to grow your crops, there's going to be international conflict over limited natural resources. Together, we can combat climate change effectively if we have the guts to stand up to the fossil fuel industry. This campaign is listening to our brothers and sisters in the African American community. And I want you to know something that you don't see on TV. I've been all over this country. I have been to Flint, Michigan, and talked to parents whose children have suffered brain damage as a result of lead in the water. I've been to Detroit, Michigan, where their public school system is on the verge of a fiscal collapse. I've been to Chicago, where dozens of decent schools have been shut down. I've been to Milwaukee, where you have whole parts of that city in extreme poverty. I've been to Baltimore, where tens of thousands of people are addicted to heroin. And I've been to communities where people are paying 40, 50, 60% of their limited incomes for housing. And I've been to communities where the school systems are failing, where poverty rate among children is 30, 40, 50%. And what the African American community is asking me, and they are absolutely right, how is it that we have trillions of dollars to invest in a war in Iraq that we never should have gotten into, and yet we cannot rebuild inner cities in America? Well, you know what? If we have the political will, we can rebuild America. Instead of seeing youth unemployment rates for high school graduates of 30, 40, 50%, how about providing those young people with jobs and education rather than jails and incarceration? How about giving those young men and women the tools to build affordable housing, clean water, clean wastewater plants? Let's rebuild our country, put people to work, rather than have 2.2 million people in jail in America. This campaign is listening to our brothers and sisters in the Latino community. And what they are telling us, that there are 11 million undocumented people in this country, many of them today, right now, are being exploited. Because when you don't have any legal rights, your employer can take advantage of you, not have to pay you the wages that you are owed, terrible working conditions. Together, we must move, in my view, to comprehensive immigration reform and a path toward citizenship. This campaign is listening to a people whose voices very rarely get heard, and that is the Native American community. They are a very small part of our population, but we owe the Native American people a debt of gratitude that, in fact, we can never repay. They have taught us so much, and among many other things, what they have taught us is that as human beings, we are part of nature, and we have got to live with nature, and that our species, human beings, will not make it if we continue to destroy nature. And that is a legacy that we have received from the Native Americans, who understand that truth better than perhaps any other people. Now, what this campaign is about is asking all of you and every American to think outside of the box and think outside of the status quo and to ask the questions that the media does not ask, and that most politicians do not ask. Questions like, and I know this seems like a strange question, as human beings, what are our rights? What are we entitled to? It's a hard question. There are people out there, extreme right-wing people like the Koch brothers, who basically believe that government should have a very limited role in our society. They would like to eliminate Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, federal aid to education. That is their vision. Their vision is, they're upfront about it, is that government should play a very limited role. And if you're a billionaire, that's great. If you don't have any money, tough luck. You are on your own. You don't have any health insurance? Hey, not the government's job, not other people's job to be there for you. That's their view. It's a minority point of view, but it is a point of view that many billionaires have today. Now, I have, needless to say, a very different perspective. I believe that in a democratic, civilized society, we can provide the basic necessities of life that all of our people need. Now, in a speech way back in 1944, it's a speech that, for whatever reason, never got a whole lot of attention. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt gave, that's right, one of the great presidents, that's right. FDR gave a speech, I think it was a State of the Union speech in 1944, if I'm not mistaken. And what he talked about was the need for a second Bill of Rights. All right, what does that mean? First Bill of Rights provides us with freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of, dissent, all of the basic freedoms, political freedoms, that we enjoy as Americans and that we are very proud of. But what he said in 1944, he said, we have got to go further. He says, is a person really free if that person is working for low wages and is struggling every day just to keep their heads above water? Is a person really free if that person gets sick but can't afford to go to a doctor? Is that person really free if he or she cannot get the education that they need? And what he was talking about, this was a long time ago, back in 44, is the need for a new Bill of Rights, which says that in a democratic, civilized, great nation like ours, we have got to rethink the rights of our people. And one of the major rights where we are lagging today behind every other major country is the issue of health care. Now, I want all of you to know what you may not know, because the TV folks don't talk about this very much. We are the only major country on earth not to provide health care to all people. Do most of you know that? How many of you have been to Europe? Anybody here been to Europe? Good. All right. If you go to the UK, if you go to France, if you go to Germany, if you go to Scandinavia, if you go to Canada, I live 50 miles away from the Canadian border, all of those countries, every major country says that health care is a right of all people. And you think it through. You think it through for 5 seconds. All right, we have a medical problem here? Okay, we're on it. If you think it through for 5 seconds, if you are poor or working class and you get sick, should you be able to receive the same quality health care as somebody who has a lot of money? I agree. Health care should be a right of all of our people, a moral right of all of our people. That's who we should be. Now, what does that mean? Now, I worked with President Obama. We passed the Affordable Care Act, and that was a good piece of legislation. It helped a lot of people in this country. But we have got to do more. Today, there are 29 million people with no health insurance. Many of you are underinsured with high deductibles and copayments. And what these guys in the CWA are fighting over right now is whether or not they're going to have decent health care. And that's a fight that's going on all over this country. And yet today, what about the drug companies? They're ripping off every American, charging us the highest prices in the world for prescription drugs. And that is why I believe that when we end up paying much more per capita on health care than any other people in the world, and our outcomes are not better, they're worse in many cases, We need to move toward a Medicare for all healthcare system. You know what that means? It means that Americans will not have to stay in jobs they do not want just because they get decent health care at their jobs. It means that any one of you can exercise your entrepreneurial capabilities, start a new business, and not worry about whether your family has health care. And it means for the average middle class family that we can save thousands of dollars a year on their health care costs. All of you know that the history of our country is about change taking place from the bottom on up, never from the top on down. Real change is never given to people. People have got to fight for it. Hundred plus years ago, when workers were forced to work 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, when children were working in factories and on farms, working people came together and they said, we will not accept that reality. We're human beings, we're not animals, we're not beasts of burden. We're going to form unions and we're going to engage in collective bargaining. And the men and women of the trade union movement helped create the middle class of America. It wasn't given to them, they fought for it. 200 years ago, within the abomination of slavery, African Americans and their allies said, we are going to fight for a different America. An America not based on racism, discrimination, segregation, and bigotry. And many of those people went to jail, and some died in that struggle to help end racism in the United States. And 100 years ago, not a long time, we forget that women in America did not have the right to vote. Women did not have a right to get the education they wanted or the jobs they wanted less than 100 years ago. But women stood up and fought back with their male allies to say that in America, women will not be second-class citizens. And for a very long time, people in the gay community and their straight allies, they stood up against incredible hatred and hostility, which still exists today if you go to Mississippi and North Carolina and see the legislation that those states have just passed. But the gay community and their straight allies said, you know what? In America, people should have the right to love whoever they want, regardless of their gender. And today, gay marriage is legal in 50 states in this country because of that effort. And all across America today, and what this campaign is about, there are people looking at the status quo. They're looking at massive levels of income and wealth inequality, and they are asking, why is it happening that almost all new income and wealth is going to the top 1%. Why is it happening that we are the only major country on earth not to guarantee paid family and medical leave, not to guarantee health care to all people? Why is our infrastructure crumbling? Why are there cities in America where 40 or 50% of the children are living in poverty? Why aren't we doing more to combat climate change? Why are women making 79 cents on the dollar compared to men? Why do we have more people in jail than any other country on earth? These are the questions that people are beginning to ask. And the conclusion that they are reaching is that status quo establishment politics and establishment economics is no longer working for the middle class or working class of this country. And from coast to coast, people are standing up. They are fighting back, and they are saying that we need a government which represents all of us, not just wealthy campaign contributors. Tomorrow, there is a very important Democratic primary here in Pennsylvania. And as I understand that, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we have same-day registration here in Pennsylvania. Is that right? We do not have same-day registration. All right. All right. I would hope that most of you, how many of you are registered to vote? How many of you are coming out to vote tomorrow? Okay. That's what I wanted to hear. This is what we have found. All over this country, what we have found is that when voter turnout is high, we do very well. And I believe that if there is a high voter turnout tomorrow, we're going to win here in Pennsylvania. So come out to vote tomorrow. Bring your friends and your coworkers, your uncles and your aunts. Let's have the largest voter turnout in Pennsylvania history tomorrow. Thank you very much.